Okay, good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is rural affairs, land reform and islands. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak button during the relevant question. I can advise the chamber that question one has been withdrawn. Question two, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it will take account of the views of Ayrshire farmers as part of its proposed agriculture bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
In the autumn of last year, in preparation for the Agriculture Bill, we ran a wide-ranging series of consultation events across Scotland to listen to the views of stakeholders as well as members of the public too. And this included a very well-attended event in Ayr where Ayrshire farmers and producers shared their views on what needs to feature in the draft bill to ensure that the future adaptive framework can respond to any social, economic and environmental changes, challenges and opportunities.
Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. I recently met with Ayrshire farmers in Kilmarnock and heard from them some of their issues and hopes too for the new Agriculture Bill. One of their recurring concerns is that they feel powerless to influence the behaviour of the supermarkets when it comes to getting fair prices for their quality products. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise this? And whilst we have no powers in this regard, would she be willing to meet with the farmers at some point over the summer, perhaps, to listen to their concerns directly and to also hear their suggestions to take many of these matters forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to do that and to engage with the member and to meet with him and any farmers in his constituency as well. I absolutely recognise the importance of the issues that he's raised, and those are issues that are repeatedly raised with me in this role and with different producers as I travel across Scotland. I'll also be looking forward to that engagement that, of course, we'll be having over the course of the next couple of days through the Royal Highland Show. But I've also been in touch with supermarkets directly to have those conversations with them. And the member will no doubt also be aware that this was an issue that was raised through the Food Security and Supply Task Force that we had last year, and one of the recommendations that came out of the report from the work of that task force was about engaging with the Competition Markets Authority and the groceries adjudicator to raise these exact issues.
A couple of supplementaries for Sian Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's better for the climate to use homegrown produce than to fly in costly imports.
Can we have Ms Dowie's microphone, please? You start again, Ms Dowie.
It's better for the climate to use homegrown produce than to fly in costly imports with associated food miles emissions. Local food is high quality and produced to high environmental standards. Buying local also helps Ayrshire farmers to keep producing the first-class food they are renowned for. The Scottish Conservatives have a plan for this with our Sustainable Food Future policy. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether the Agriculture Bill will learn from our policy and help to encourage more people and organisations in Ayrshire to buy good local food?
We are going to need briefer supplementaries and briefer answers. Cabinet Secretary.
I'll try to be as brief as possible, Presiding Officer. But just to say, first of all, that I do absolutely agree with the points that have been made by the member there about the importance of supporting our local producers, having those short and resilient supply chains. But I think that's where it's unfortunate then that, unfortunately, her party and the UK government have signed us up to trade deals which will see those imports, which are undercutting our industry in Scotland.
And Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On a recent visit to Mineside Farm near Lockerbie, the message from farmers was once again that the uncertainty over future mechanisms for funding it was causing real concern. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us when will the Agricultural Bill be published, and will it provide the details of what is expected of farmers to secure that funding going forward? Because that uncertainty is a major concern.
Cabinet Secretary.
One point I want to make, first of all, and that I've made previously in the Chamber, is that there absolutely will be no cliff edges when it comes to support for our farmers going forward. In terms of the Agriculture Bill and when that's introduced, in line with the commitments and what I've outlined already, we are aiming to introduce the bill this year. In terms of the clarity and future direction of support, I think it's important to highlight to the Member and to others across the Chamber as well about our agriculture route map and the route map to reform that we've set out. Lines within that, when the key changes will be coming forward, when we will be providing more of that information and more of that detail there. So I would encourage the member to take a look at that, and we will be, of course, updating that as we go forward.
Question three, Ross McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it believes muir burn is a crucial tool for preventing and controlling wildfires.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm aware of the recent devastation caused by wildfires. The Rural Affairs Secretary recently visited the site at Daviot to thank forestry staff, firefighters and the local community for their work tackling wildfires. Sadly, the risk of wildfires in Scotland is likely to increase with climate change. We must continue to tackle this issue and encourage people to behave responsibly when outdoors. And of course, muir burn can make a significant contribution to the prevention and control of wildfires. Our Wildlife Management and Muir Burn Bill includes provisions which permit muir burn to prevent and reduce the risk of wildfires.
Ross McCall.
Thank you. Professor Heinmeier at University of York has been studying peatlands for two decades and has said that regarding the ways to prevent wildfires, you come across a lot of re-wetting will solve all the issues, but it's not guaranteed. You can't get a wet bog everywhere because of different rainfall amounts. That's wishful thinking. So if we want a down-to-earth thinking which will prevent wildfires, protect the peatland and the species which live in the area, muir burn must be an important tool in our land management's inventory. And I recognise that the Minister said that there would be some. So can the Minister confirm again that muir burn bill will not regulate this practice to a last resort, risking the damage of unnecessary wildfires?
Minister.
I agree with a lot of what Ros McCall has said, and I can confirm again, if she would like me to, is that we do recognise that licensing muir burn will allow muir burn to take place, particularly in areas where it is mitigating any risk from wildfire. But I would actually say as well that in terms of peatland, re-wetting peatland is also a tool that we have in our box in controlling wildfires as well, not just from the point of view of actually sequestering the carbon that's out there as a result of climate change, but also providing those areas in which actually the burning will actually be controlled because of wet peatland and re-established peatland.
I've got a number of supplementaries. They will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the seriousness of recent wildfires and the impact this has had on forestry staff and fire officers, shame on the Tories for turning this into a political football. The Scottish Government has already stated that there are situations where muir burn is the best option. Minister, can you confirm that the Government is seeking only to ensure that muir burn is used where appropriate and that the best practice is followed?
Minister.
I appreciate that there are a range of views on muir burn, and I am, as I've said in my response to Ros McCall, completely aware that muir burn can be a very positive tool when used appropriately, creating beneficial habitats for certain species and helping reduce fuel loads and lower the risk of wildfires and also control the risk of wildfires. The introduction of the muir burn licensing through the Wildlife Management and Muir Burn Bill will ensure that muir burn is undertaken in a safe and environmentally sustainable manner with best practice, in line with best practice, and the licensing scheme will allow muir burn for a number of purposes, including preventing or reducing the risk of wildfires.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Upland management is so important, particularly for public health, but also for biodiversity. Can I ask the Minister whether Azulox will be approved in Scotland, which is an urgent matter?
I don't think that's relevant to muir burn. I'm going to move on to Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I was going to ask a similar question, because dry bracken clearly is a major risk of wildfire, which is what the topic of this question is. So can I ask the Minister, when will the use of Azulox to control bracken be granted in Scotland, given permission was given in England last week?
Minister, is there anything you can add to what you've already said?
No, there isn't. I mean, I've made my point on the licensing of muir burn, so I think I'm just going to stick with that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Okay, question number four, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the reported concerns of farmers about the potential impact on their productivity of beaver relocation.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The reintroduction of beavers brings clear benefits for our biodiversity and ecosystems. I do understand, however, that beavers can have adverse impacts on some types of agriculture. I have not met with ministerial colleagues, including the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, to discuss this issue in particular. NatureScot have a range of mitigation measures to help protect farms, and there are arrangements that allow lethal control of animals as a last resort.
Additionally, all translocation projects must follow the process in the Scottish Code for Conservation Translocations, including appropriate engagement with those most likely to be affected.
Tim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Minister for that answer. Now, beaver numbers are expected to rise to 10,000 before the end of the decade, and this is clearly a cause of concern for farmers who are justifiably worried of the threat of beavers posed to their land, given the proven evidence that they will cause significant and costly agricultural damage should they appear in the wrong areas. Back in 2019, the then Environment Secretary, Rosanna Cunningham, gave an assurance that the Scottish farming would not be compromised by beavers. What mitigation does the government intend for those already affected by beaver damage, and how will relocated beavers be managed to avoid unnecessary damage to farmland in the areas they are relocated to?
Minister.
Our Scottish beaver strategy was developed in partnership with stakeholders, including NFUS and the Scottish Lands and Estates, and provides a direction of travel for beavers in Scotland. The Scottish Code for Conservation Translocation sets out the consultation process for proposed projects and ensures those likely to be affected by proposals can have their views heard. Nature Scots' beaver management scheme is integral to our work in managing beaver impacts. This scheme provides farmers and other land managers with mitigation advice, including proactive measures to prevent beaver impacts. This includes tree protection, the installation of flow devices, and beaver exclusion fencing, for example. While we consider lethal control to be a last resort, licensing approaches are available to prevent serious damage where mitigation cannot resolve the conflict.
Supplementary, Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I remind the Parliament of my interests in farming and forestry on space. Farming and fishing on spey fires. Beavers don't just damage crops; they damage trees too. Given this government has missed its tree planting targets again last year. How does the Minister propose to protect the important young riparian trees that are being planted to mitigate the damages by beaver reintroductions? And please don't suggest wrapping them in plastic.
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. As I have said in my set out in my previous answer, the beaver strategy, which outlines the direction of travel for beavers in Scotland, has been developed with over 50 stakeholders working toward that, including the Scottish Wildlife Trust, as I have said, the NFUS and Scottish Lands and Estates. They have collaborated on the strategy aims, and these are in line with our aims as a government. This strategy also sets out the importance of community engagement in achieving those aims. And again, as I have previously set out, installation of protection for valuable trees is part of our beaver mitigation measures, and we will continue to support that going forward.
Question 5, Liz Smith.
What measures it's put in place to support new entrants into agriculture.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continue to invest in new entrants and the rural workforce. Since 2015, we've granted in excess of £28 million through a combination of National Reserve, Start-up and Capital Grant schemes. And additionally, we've provided 122 land opportunities through the Farming Opportunities for New Entrants Group, supported over 82 joint ventures through the Scottish Land Matching Service, and continue to offer a range of general and bespoke consultancy advice to new entrants through the Farm Advisory Service. And we're also pleased to be supporting the Machinery Ring pre-apprenticeship programme to really try and create those opportunities for young people in rural areas.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. That's helpful, but the Cabinet Secretary is also aware of several corporate entities that are buying up large tracts of property for forestry in order to meet climate change targets, and that means that substantial areas of land are being taken out of agricultural use at a time when we desperately need food security. That's something that's concerning constituents in Perthshire who've raised this matter with me on grounds that it also deters new entrants into agriculture. So can I ask the Scottish Government what it will do to address these concerns?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am aware of the concerns about that, and I think Liz Smith raises a really important point. But I think one thing that I would say that we see coming through the forestry grant scheme is that about 80% of applications through that are actually for smaller pieces of land and for small farms as well. I think we do want to ensure that we are putting the right tree in the right place. I think there is a strong role for forestry and agriculture, whether that's agroforestry. We have an integrating trees network as well, which I think shows how we can combine that, because the member also raises a really critical point about our food security. As with a lot of the issues that we discuss here, it's about us ensuring that we get that balance right. But we want to continue to see that integrated land use, because that does have benefits, not just for our environment, but for the farm businesses as well.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Emma Harper.
Presiding Officer, it's regarding the new entrance. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm how much funding the Scottish Government provided for new entrants and young farmers since 2015 and how that compares with other nations of the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, the Scottish Government has invested considerable sums for new entrants over the course of a number of years. And since 2015, we provided around just over £7 million worth of support via direct payments. We've provided around £12 million through the Young Farmer Startup Grant, as well as £600,000 for the New Entrants Startup Grant too. And I think it's important to highlight that these forms of support for new entrants in England were discontinued.
Briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the contributions that new people in the sector can make to both food security and biodiversity loss, what additional measures can the Scottish Government take in terms of retention of new crofting and agriculture entrants?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that's a really important point that the member has raised, and we have obviously committed in our manifesto to providing new entrant support. I think it's important that we learn from the schemes that we've had in the past, and I was also delighted to attend one of the farming opportunities for new entrants groups in Bute last week, and it was really interesting there to hear from the farmers directly and the young farmers there about some of the challenges that they've faced in terms of getting those opportunities. We want to make sure that we are breaking down those barriers and providing those opportunities. So I'm keen that we learn from schemes we've had in the past as we look to develop new support.
Question 6, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when the report by the Task Force to consider whether to extend wildlife crime investigation powers to the Scottish SPCA will be published.
Minister Gillian Moore.
Thank Megan Gallagher for that question. The report provided by the Scottish SPCA Task Force has been published on the Scottish Government website this morning, and I want to thank the SPCA Task Force for conducting the review and producing that final report, and I'll be providing a response to the recommendations in the report in due course.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank the Minister for her answer. On Monday, I had the pleasure of joining the Scottish Raptor Study Group to visit red kite nests. The conversation centred around the importance of red kite conservation. However, the team also highlighted incidents of raptor persecution, a practice which I'm sure we will all condemn. The SSPCA is facing financial difficulties at present. I am concerned that should the Scottish Government not fund this organisation correctly, officers will be stretched when trying to fulfil their duties. This would include investigation powers, should this be approved by Parliament. Therefore, can I ask the Minister what reassurances she can provide to ensure that the SSPCA are fully supported?
Minister.
I thank Megan Gallagher for that question, and I appreciate everything that she said about raptor persecution and agree with an awful lot of her concerns. The Scottish SPCA is not government funded, but Scottish Government officials meet regularly with the SPCA to discuss current issues and provide support when appropriate. Like many charities, its income comes from other means, including membership, fundraising and legacy donations amongst others. But we'll do everything in consultation with the SPCA to make sure that they're supported to carry out any duties should we decide to give them to them.
And brief supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. Barriers under existing powers mean that SSPCA inspectors who are already on the ground investigating animal abuse are prevented from seizing and securing evidence of wildlife-related crimes. And inspectors are further limited to enforcing powers only on living animals, with their hands tied if a wild animal is found dead. So does the Minister agree that this is inexcusable, and will she close these loopholes in future stages of the Wildlife Management Bill?
Minister.
Ruskell for that question, and he'll know that when I was in the same committee as him in the last term, we heard exactly that kind of concern being raised about SSPCA officers not being able to act in certain situations that they found that there had been animal cruelty, particularly in wildlife. So I guess the report that's been published today has outlined what the SSPCA say that they can do in this space. I'm absolutely open to what we can do to support them to do that and close those loopholes.
Question number 7, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will introduce compulsory sales orders through its proposed land reform bill in the light of its plans to address the need for effective, efficient and fair land assembly powers for public bodies as referred to in the Bute House Agreement.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise the importance of effective, efficient and fair land assembly powers for public bodies, and that's why we are committed to reviewing compulsory purchase order powers to ensure that they remain fit for purpose, and we'll be appointing an expert advisory panel over the course of this year and the start of next year to help inform the development of those options for reform. Work on the introduction of compulsory sales orders was undertaken in the last parliamentary term, and it will be considered more fully in this one too.
Arianne Burgess.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's encouraging that the Scottish Government is investing £10 million in projects this year to tackle the waste of derelict land, such as decontamination and redevelopment of former military land at Cromarty Firth, so affordable homes can be built. But given the exceptional demand and skyrocketing prices for land right now, we must make better use of the 9,500 hectares of land that is currently benefiting neither people nor nature. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that compulsory sales orders for councils to auction long-neglected land are a necessary tool to ensure the people of Scotland are getting the most out of their land?
Cabinet Secretary.
In my initial response, I mentioned about the work that will be undertaken in compulsory purchase orders, and councils already have tools such as that that they are using to repurpose land for the benefit of local communities and for their local areas too. But as I've highlighted, we are considering how the introduction of compulsory sales orders might enhance those tools that are already available to local authorities. But of course, we're going to continue to engage with our stakeholders in relation to that to really try and understand the need for those and to discuss the issues that I know were previously identified when this issue was initially raised during the last parliamentary term. And ultimately, that's got to include how any introduction of compulsory sales orders might comply with the European Convention on Human Rights too.
Brief supplementary, Mercedes Villalba.
The Bute House Agreement also refers to applying a public interest test to transfers of large-scale landholdings, but very few large landholdings are transferred in Scotland each year. Does the Minister agree that waiting for all large landholdings to be transferred will take decades, and that we need a public interest test that applies to existing holdings?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Member will no doubt be aware that we had a consultation on our proposals for legislation coming forward, which we published the results of a couple of weeks ago. So, of course, we're going to be considering the views that have been expressed through that legislation as we develop our proposals for a land reform bill, which we will be looking to introduce soon. So, of course, I look forward to working with the Member, discussing the issues that have arisen from that, and as we take forward the work on the bill, which will look to address these issues.
Very briefly, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. If the Scottish Government do take this forward, can the Minister confirm whether, in the event of a compulsory sale, the new landowner will then be required to put it to the use that it is designed for, and if so, explain how this would be enforced?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, it's not possible for me to set that out at the moment because, as I've said, while this issue was considered in the last parliamentary term, there is still a lot of work that would need to be undertaken in relation to that, where, of course, we would look to bottom out some of those issues that the Member has raised.
And question 8, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to reform crofting law.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Stated in the Scottish Policy Prospectus, I am committed to reform crofting law by 2026, subject to agreement by Parliament to support the future of crofting. The Crofting Bill Group has made good progress since it was reinstated in May 2022 and has reached a consensus on many topics. The Group is considering those issues raised by the Bill Group in the period of 2016 to 2018 and the issues that the Law Society of Scotland singled out for the Crofting Law Reform Project in 2020, and issues identified by the Crofting Commission to make crofting regulations less onerous for crofters and the Commission.
I'll say that one.
I thank the Minister for her answer. A range of issues daily highlight the need for crofting law reform, not least on the issue of common grazings. Given that crofting law expert Sir Crispin Agnew has noted that the current law is inadequate to manage subsidy regimes, environmental obligations and renewables opportunities, can the Minister say whether legislation will deal with those issues in particular around common grazings?
Minister.
I thank Alistair Allen for that question. As stated in the 2021 manifesto, work on crofting law reform will be undertaken during this parliamentary term, and a decision on the timing of the bill is going to be taken by the Cabinet in the context of setting the context of future legislative programmes in the normal way. Mr Allen will, of course, know the Crofting Bill Group is looking at that wide range of issues to inform that draft bill, and we've asked them to look at how we can make crofting legislation more relevant to modern crofting, and some of the things that he's mentioned are under consideration. One of the issues being considered by the Crofting Bill Group is its work on crofting law reform, its common grazings.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs, land reform and islands. There'll be a brief pause before we move on to the next portfolio. I'll allow the front benches to change. Okay, the next portfolio is NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. We've got a lot of interest in supplementaries. We are due to be sitting late this evening. There is no time in hand, and therefore questions will need to be brief, as will responses. Question number one, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government how many women are currently waiting for surgical treatment for pelvic organ prolapse.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. Information on the number of patients waiting for pelvic organ prolapse surgery is not held centrally by the Scottish Government. However, we are keen to ensure these patients are seen as soon as possible, so we are currently working with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery to adopt a national approach to expediting waits for a range of urogynaecology treatments, and work has started on this with the boards in question.
Michael Mara.
Minister for that answer. She will perhaps recognise the cases that I've raised in the Chamber, one most recently of an 8.5 year wait from one woman in my region. I've since been contacted by another two women, one who has been waiting for 14 years for this surgery. So I'm very keen to understand from the Minister, and if she can commit to doing this, to understand whether this is a national situation or something that pertains just to Tayside. And I think that if the Minister could commit to looking into that, it would be appreciated.
Minister.
Thank the member for his question, and would first of all like to apologise for women that have experienced this. I need to check with my officials and get back to you to see what information that we do hold, so I would absolutely commit to doing that with the member.
Question number two, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact it anticipates that its recent £1.8 million investment will have on dermatology services.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. This new programme, which enables primary care teams to send digital images of a patient's skin condition to specialists, could potentially reduce demand for outpatient dermatology appointments by up to 50%, with the potential for up to 90% of referrals to include a digital image. This will lead to a better and quicker service for patients, allowing clinicians to see patients in the right place sooner. Modernising our services with innovations like this is absolutely vital for the future of our healthcare service, supporting patient care and reducing pressure on our workforce.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and such innovations are indeed welcome for our NHS. I want to ask specifically about topical corticosteroid treatments for inflammatory skin conditions. And while these are generally safe and effective short term, several of my constituents have experienced withdrawal reactions after using these creams over longer periods. And they describe a range of symptoms, including burning or stinging, intense itching, peeling skin and skin redness that extends beyond the area originally treated. And the physical and emotional impact is devastating. Is the Minister able to confirm whether reducing the number of patients using topical corticosteroids for prolonged periods will be a key area of focus while work to improve treatment pathways continues?
Minister.
Thanks, Stephanie Callaghan, for that question, and recognise the conditions and the impacts that topical steroid creams can have, having spoken with people affected. This is why we're bringing in this new way of working. By capturing images in primary care and enabling triage in secondary care, the programme will support timely access for patients who need secondary care treatment while providing quicker and more specific advice back to primary care to support patients who do not. Management within primary care may include reassurance for patients with lesions, guidance to monitor the condition or medical treatment, but I should note that prescribing decisions are ultimately matters for each clinician, taking into account the individual circumstances and treatment needs of each patient.
Question number three, Graeme Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to support grassroots sport in Scotland.
Minister Marie Todd.
Earlier this month, Sport Scotland announced record annual investment figures to support the delivery of sport and physical activity. Across 2023-24, Sport Scotland will invest up to £36.7 million of Scottish Government and National Lottery funding into Scottish governing bodies of sports, local authorities and wider national partners. This includes significant investment and support for grassroots sport in Scotland, supporting local authority partners in the delivery of community and school sport through community sport hubs and the Active Schools Network. Since April 2007, Sport Scotland has invested over £204 million to help sports clubs, community groups, local authorities, sports governing bodies and other organisations deliver new and upgraded sporting facilities.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? She will be aware that councils have been forced to close facilities due to SNP cuts. I'm sure she's also aware that the UK government has invested in facilities across Scotland, including £500,000 in Lanarkshire, through its multi-sport grassroots facilities programme. So does the Scottish government have a similar specific fund for grassroots sport?
Minister.
So we've discussed the issue a number of times in the Chamber around investment in grassroots sport. As I've set out, Sport Scotland is the body that we use to make those investments, and there has been a substantial increase this year in the investments there we are making. In terms of local government finance, we do absolutely recognise the crucial role that councils and their employees play in communities across Scotland and the challenging financial circumstances that they face. But under the UK government, we have suffered a decade of austerity with average real terms cuts of more than 5%, equating to a loss of £18 billion. And despite this, local authority revenue funding is £2.2 billion, or 22.9% higher in cash terms in the current financial year than it was in 2013-14. So we have managed to protect local authority budgets. Local authorities are, of course, democratically elected bodies and make these decisions for themselves and how they spend their money and where they focus their attention. As you would expect, central government cannot interfere in those decisions.
I've got a couple of supplementaries. They will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Emma Harper.
The Minister mentioned Active Schools. Can the Minister provide an update on the work being done with Sport Scotland to ensure that Active Schools programmes are free for all children and young people by the end of this Parliament?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
Thank you very much. We're working with Sport Scotland and local authorities to phase out any charging for Active Schools. That's a really important commitment of this Parliament. Sport Scotland continues to work with partners to address the very small number of cases where charging remains, taking a managed approach to avoid any unintended negative impact on the level of sport and physical activity provision in those communities. Sport Scotland's record annual investment into local authorities last year, £16.2 million, will support them with rising staff costs and allow them to drive and strengthen Active Schools' focus on inclusion. And that focus is about supporting children who are living in poverty, those with additional support needs and care experience young people to participate.
I'm Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The school was an introduction to so many of us into sport. I wonder if what the Minister can tell us around investment into school sport and maintaining the school estate open after 4 o'clock, because sport is now becoming the bastion of the middle classes.
Minister.
So
Brian Whittle and I have engaged in this issue many times, and I recognise that we share a passion for sport. I would argue that sport is not becoming a bastion of the middle classes. It has long been a bastion of the middle classes, and in fact our data illustrates that, that other than participation in football, which has equitable participation across the socioeconomic groups, almost all other sports favour the rich, favour the wealthy. And that has long been thus. That is why this government is so focused on tackling that inequality. That is why this government is so focused on the Active Schools programme and taking any charges away from that to ensure that people, every child living in Scotland, can have the opportunity to participate in sport and gain the benefits that that brings them, not just from the physical activity, but also from the involvement in sport. As Brian Whittle can testify, it brings you lifelong benefits.
Question number four, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has for the future of community link practitioners working with GP practices, in particular in more deprived areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
We remain committed to community link workers in general practice. Their role aligns strongly with the missions on equality and community in our policy prospectus, in which we also committed to increasing investment in general practice serving disadvantaged areas. Funding for primary care improvement plans has been maintained at £170 million in this financial year, and each HSCP determines how to deliver link worker services within its own improvement plan. The Scottish Government recognises that there are service variations across Scotland, and we are currently reviewing local community link worker delivery to understand the benefits and challenges of these different approaches.
John Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I take his point that the HSCPs are very much central to how this goes forward. But I just wonder if he would agree with me that these link workers are very much valued by GP practices, especially in deep end areas in constituencies like mine. And would he agree that if the GP practices and everybody else had a bit more certainty over funding for the future, that would help the patients, it would help the GP practices, and it would help the staff themselves?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do agree with the points which have been raised by Mr Mason and the very specific issues which he's raised in regarding his own constituency. I do appreciate that there has been a level of uncertainty for both staff and also for patients who have benefited from the Community Link Worker programme, and I'm pleased that we have been able to address that uncertainty as a member made reference to. And I recognise that the health and social care partnerships are working to try and address some of the contractual issues going forward as well. I also want to just reassure the member that as part of the review programme which we are taking forward, I want to look at how we can give that greater level of certainty going forward and also a greater level of consistency in how community link workers are going to be provided within general practices, particularly in our more deprived areas, in order to make sure that we're dealing with these issues in a consistent way, but in a way that people have got assurance around our long-term vision in taking this forward.
For a number of supplementaries, they will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. I agree we need more community link workers and absolutely value them when I get to work with them in practice, but the SNP have broken their promise to GPs with a new contract. The £65 million cut has broken the SNP promise to all primary care, and the GP contract is and was detrimental in rural areas. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary why primary care and GP should believe him now?
Cabinet Secretary.
And officer, we've got a very strong commitment to primary care, and we're one of the examples of our commitment to improving and investing in primary care has been a very rapid expansion of the multidisciplinary team across primary care. Over 3,000 additional staff brought into that particular group, including AHPs, in order to expand capacity within our primary care setting, supporting GPs in their work, alongside the very important work that our community link workers carry out, which shows a very clear example of this government's determination to expand and develop our primary care setting.
Briefly, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Community link workers do play a crucial role, particularly in community mental health support. The SNP's last programme for government committed to establish 1,000 additional mental health roles to support wellbeing hubs for every GP practice and improve community mental health resilience. Cabinet Secretary, summer recess begins next week. Will the Scottish Government have created these roles before the next programme for government, or will this be yet another failed commitment by this government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Representative Officer, we are determined to do everything we can to help to support the issues around mental health and the services that can help to support individuals who are experiencing mental health challenges. But we've also had to look at prioritisations within our budget, given the budget cuts which we're experiencing as a result of decisions being made by the UK Government, which have a direct impact on the Scottish Government's budget. But what I can assure the member of is that we will continue to look at what further support we can provide in the way of community mental health support to GP practices in order to make sure that we provide the support and assistance that's required.
Again, very briefly, Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary's presentation is not what people are facing in our communities. They're waiting a long time to get through to a GP because the recruitment has failed completely. If you look at the number of whole-time equivalents has dropped for GPs. 23 practices have closed in the last 3 years. The multidisciplinary recruitment that he talks about has fallen well short of the targets. So I support like workers, but why doesn't he get real and understand that people are really suffering in accessing GPs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Community link workers are an important part of the primary care team, but I suspect that the member has chosen to ignore the over 3,000 additional staff that were recruited into primary care over the course of the last couple of years in order to expand and help to support capacity within that sector. Notwithstanding that, I recognise there are challenges within it. In itself, in my constituency MSP, I'm very aware of the challenges that some of our constituents have, which is why we're also looking to increase our recruitment within general practice as well. But there is a need for us to look at how we actually configure primary care to make sure that we are referring people into the right services in the right way. And that is about looking at the whole multidisciplinary team, GPs and the wider AHP team that can help to support patients with long-term conditions and to meet even short-term conditions as well. And that's exactly what this government is determined to do, and that's the approach we're taking going forward.
Question number five, Donald Cameron.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with NHS boards in the Highlands and Islands region regarding whether there has been any impact in the delivery of their services as a result of recent ferry cancellations.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government officials regularly meet with all NHS boards, including Highlands and Islands, to discuss any challenges impacting activity and to provide any necessary support. We have not been made aware of any specific impact on the Northern Isles. However, I understand that some outpatient activity was postponed in the Western Isles, where travel was disrupted for visiting consultants. Patients affected were reappointed at the next available opportunity. However, contingencies are in place for patients. For example, CalMac has a medical protocol which guarantees Islanders a booking on the ferry and a taxi should they have an urgent medical appointment to attend on the mainland. And Northlink will provide assistance to any Northern Isles residents with issues travelling to the mainland for medical appointments.
Donald Cameron.
In addition to the problems the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, the Oban Times recently reported that the hospital on Isla was unable to book patients onto ferries this month due to reduced deck space. And in addition, the Scottish Ambulance Service has confirmed to me that the recent Corran ferry breakdown resulted in longer travel times for patients and delays getting cover back to the area. So what additional help can be provided to health boards to ensure patients can access vital health services in the event of problems with the ferry network?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Senator Officer, I do recognise some of the challenges which have been experienced by patients who require to make use of ferries for the purposes of accessing services or coming onto the mainland for services. And of course, we would expect boards to look at alternative arrangements being put in place where that is feasible to do so. But the critical aspect here is to get greater consistency and reliability within our ferry network in order to address these issues. And of course, the member will be well aware of the actions that have been taken forward in order to address these issues. But we expect boards to make sure that where it's necessary, that alternative arrangements are put in place, and if appointments have to be rearranged, that they are rearranged at as early a point as possible for patients.
Question six, Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government how many nursing and midwifery staff have left NHS in the last 12 months.
Cabinet Secretary.
8,831 nursing and midwifery staff have left the NHS in the last 12 months. This information can be found at Tourist, which is in the Scottish Government Workforce Planning Programme.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. New statistics have revealed that the use of staff from agency in that period has increased dramatically, rising to the equivalent of 1,741 whole-time equivalent nursing and midwifery staff in 22-23, which is up from 1,018 in 21-22, a rise of more than 70%. We know that nurses and midwives continue to leave the profession in their droves due to stress and burnout, and we know that even though there's an astronomic use of agency, people actually can't even access agency staff, and wards are being left in very perilous positions. So I know that the Cabinet Secretary has not been in post for that long, but he must accept that these are clear failures in workforce planning, and he must take responsibility to address the issue. Therefore, I would ask, when is he going to prioritise the work of the new Nursing and Midwifery Task Force to ensure it delivers a plan for providing the nursing workforce Scotland needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me deal with the issue in terms of the use of agency and his call for us to take action to address these issues. I'm not sure whether the member's aware, but action's already been taken. New protocols were introduced at the beginning of this month, which place restrictions on health boards in order to reduce the amount of agency which they are using and to switch more towards using bank staff. So action has been taken on that and applying restrictions to health boards on that, and I hope the member will find that new information helpful to him. In relation to prioritising the task force, I'm a little surprised at the tone of his question in this matter. The task force has already met. I chair the task force. We're actually due to have a second meeting. The work of the task force is already progressing, and what I will do is I'll work with all of those partners within the task force to make sure we address the issues that it's set up to address, and that includes looking at further pathways into profession. And no doubt the member will welcome the work that's been taken forward to date by the task force.
Be supplementary, Claire Hawhey.
Analysis by the Nuffield Foundation, among others, makes clear that Brexit is a key factor in the NHS staffing crisis. And this week marks 7 years since Scotland voted overwhelmingly to remain in the EU, and yet we continue to feel the full force of the Tories' hard Brexit deal, which Labour fully supports. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on efforts to ensure the further recruitment of midwives and allied health professionals from overseas in the face of these pressures?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
There is absolutely no doubt that Brexit is having a significant impact on recruitment within a whole range of sectors, not just here in Scotland, but right across the UK and including within the health and social care setting. That's the reality, that's the facts on the ground, which is a challenge which we now have to address, despite the fact that the people of Scotland, by a significant majority, voted against leaving the EU. We have been taking action to try to help to increase our recruitment from overseas. We recently were able to exceed our target of recruiting an extra 750 nurses and AHPs from overseas, exceeding that by some 800 offers being made to staff. And we'll continue to take further work forward by our health boards to look at how we can increase recruitment further in the years ahead.
And briefly, Sue Webber.
Cabinet Secretary, some new fearsome facts from on the ground, because they've in fact shown that for the first time, the number of staff leaving the health service has outstripped the number joining, with 75,000 NHS staff being absent due to mental illness over the last 5 years. It's of little surprise that record numbers of NHS staff are leaving the health service. Recruiting more NHS staff will have little effect if existing staff are leaving at a higher rate. So what steps is the Cabinet Secretary taking to ensure our NHS staff are valued, respected and protected? And does he accept that this predecessor, Hamza Youssef, bears responsibility
Cabinet Secretary,
for this exodus?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we're taking forward a range of work in order to continue to recruit into our NHS. But as I mentioned, I'm sure the member will recognise the very significant challenges Brexit are now posing for the recruitment of staff, and including the work we're doing now as well with our... I don't know if the member wants to hear what I've got to say, or she's just going to sit from a serious position shouting at me. But, for example, the point was raised by Paul O'Kane around the Nursing Midwifery Task Force is very specific about how we can look at new routes into the healthcare professions, particularly into nursing, through apprenticeships and earn-as-you-learn programmes, all of which can open up the opportunity to do that. I would just gently point out to the member is that we have more NHS staff in our NHS since this government has come into office. And alongside that, we have more NHS staff per head of population in Scotland than we do have when we have with what the Tories have in England, which demonstrates our commitment to invest in our staff, and will continue to take that forward despite the very poor record that our own party have in England.
Question 7, Murdo Fraser.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it and NHS Scotland are taking to implement the recommendations of the CAS review into gender identity services for children and young people as they apply to Scotland.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The NHS England commissioned CAST review only extends to clinical services as offered by NHS England. It is not considering or reviewing services as provided within NHS Scotland. How the NHS is structured, as the member will know, and how services are commissioned is different in England and Scotland. However, as we continue to state, the ongoing findings of that review are being closely considered in the context of how such healthcare is best delivered here. This is alongside other national and international evidence in this field, as we collectively work to improve service delivery to children, young people and their families. Various work streams are underway to deliver that. Officials and senior clinicians from both Scottish Government and NHS Scotland have met with Dr Cass twice to date to share information on improvement work in Scotland, expected outputs of that review, associated timelines and opportunities for shared learnings.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for her response? As she will know, the CAST review highlighted the significant uncertainty surrounding the use of hormone treatments for children and adolescents with gender dysphoria, reflecting the views and concerns of many in the medical profession. On the 9th of June, NHS England announced that puberty blockers would not be commissioned for children and young people in these categories, except as part of clinical research. Will the NHS in Scotland, in light of the very serious concerns that have been highlighted, also now be taking this step? If so, when? And if not, why not?
Minister.
I thank the member for his questions. Decisions on this type of treatment to prescribe are for clinicians to make in consultation with their patient following individualised assessment, and which could be subject to regular monitoring. The Scottish Government remains proactive in our commitment to help deliver high-quality healthcare to children and young people in this sensitive field of medicine. Consistent with this, preliminary discussions between Scottish Government and NHS England officials are ongoing as to what form of engagement may be possible and appropriate with NHS England's recent announced and not yet in place clinical research study on puberty blockers. However, the current situation in Scotland remains unchanged.
Question number 8, Cocab Stewart.
To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has undertaken of the results of the NHS Scotland's significant adverse event reviews.
Cabinet Secretary.
The National Adverse Events Notification Scheme has been in place since the 1st of January 2020, following the then Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sports' instruction to Healthcare Improvement Scotland to collect significant adverse event review data for Category 1 adverse events from health boards. Health boards are responsible for delivering safe, effective and person-centred care at a local level, and this includes inputting into the national notification system. The Scottish Government does not routinely request this data from Healthcare Improvement Scotland. However, we are working closely with Healthcare Improvement Scotland to ensure that these processes are implemented and improved in line with national policies and the framework.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. According to NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's own publication of 2020-21, the most common SER contributory factor was guidance not being followed. Last year, my constituent, Cathana McGiven, who is in the chamber today, sadly lost her grandfather, John, while he was receiving NHS care. The SER carried out confirmed that guidance had not been followed, which may have caused or contributed to his death. How can the Government and NHS Scotland effectively learn from adverse events to improve the guidance provided and allow best practice to be actively promoted across Scotland?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Signed Officer, can I begin by saying I'm sorry to hear of the loss of Ms McGivern's grandfather, John, and I believe she may have written to me separately on this particular matter. Can I say that safety is at the very heart of everything that we do, and the National Adverse Events Framework has been developed by Healthcare Improvement Scotland in collaboration with NHS boards. Its purpose is to provide an overarching framework and is developed from using best practice to support care providers to effectively manage what are adverse events when they occur. I can assure a member that this framework is currently being reviewed by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, and we're looking at what further work can be taken forward to ensure that we continue to learn from significant adverse events. And we are taking forward a piece of work around what's called the community of practice, which has been trialled with NHS boards as part of the adverse events framework to ensure that we're maximising the learning that can come from these incidents.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.